One day, Jesus is coming. You may be at church. You may be at work. You may be asleep. God grant that you will be ready when he makes his personal appearance. My God, what if his appearance occurs on a Sunday morning? My prophetic word to you this morning is get ready, get ready.
יברכך אדוני וישמרך. יאר אדוני פניו אליך ויחונקה. יישא אדוני פניו אליך וישם לך שלום.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
And good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. Happy Sunday. And welcome to this NTEB House Church Sunday service. We're so glad that you're here today. Our topic this morning is laying hold on eternal life and building a good foundation against the time that's coming for us all. Just minutes before he would meet his death at the hands of the Auca Indians, missionary Jim Elliot wrote this in his diary. I walked out to the hill just now. It is exhilarating, delicious, to stand embraced by the shadows of a friendly tree, with the wind tugging at your coattail and the heavens hailing your heart. To gaze in glory and give oneself again to God, what more could a man ask? Oh, the fullness, pleasure, sheer excitement of knowing God on earth. With that, he was brutally murdered and ushered into the presence of God. Jim Elliot knew something that you don't know, and he died a happy man because of it. And the question that we'd like to ask you today is, how will you die? 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 19, Paul says, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Jim Elliot died in the cause of attempting to bring the gospel to the violent tribe of the Auca Indians, his last breath spent on the battlefield of the Lord as a 2 Timothy 2:3 soldier laying hold on eternal life. Now, you might be tempted to say that it was a shame for him to have died that way, to lose your life to savages. But you'd be quite wrong. Jim Elliot also said this, he is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose. Now, in that, we have the true essence of the gospel, laying hold on eternal life, even if it comes at the cost of this one. Today, on this Sunday service, I want to talk to you about building a good foundation in this life that'll prepare you for the time to come and for the Hebrews 9:27 unbreakable appointment that we all have with the Lord. You can absolutely be ready for that day, and the Bible tells us how, and that is the topic of my message today. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you. We praise you. And Lord, it's so good to meet on this Sunday. Your word says this in Acts chapter 20, verse 7. And upon the first day of the week, that's a Sunday, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart on the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight. And we're so glad, God, to have, we don't need a Sabbath day. We're glad that you gave that to the Jewish people, but you gave us you. We have the Sabbath. We have, and you are our rest. And we come before you today, God, and we commit this time, this Sunday service, and we're so glad to be here. And Lord, as we open up your word and we gather once again by the way of radio, that meet with us, Lord, and lead us and guide us with your Holy Spirit and give us something that will help us to build that good foundation and to lay hold on eternal life, Lord. And I will give you all the honor and the glory for it, for you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. You know, it's the easiest thing in the world to get saved. All you have to do is believe the gospel. Acts chapter 16, verses 30 and 31. And he brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Well, it's like this. You got to join a church. You got to be baptized. You got to tithe." No, they didn't say anything like that. All they said was, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved and thy house." And getting saved is the easiest thing in the world. A six-year-old child could do it. My grandmother, 5 days short of 100 years old, heard the gospel on her deathbed, believed it, received it, and is in heaven right now. Anybody can get saved. The Bible says that God is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But what happens after salvation? That's also something that we need to pay attention to. Now, it is true that you can get saved, you can believe the gospel and receive the Lord as your Savior, and you can make that great transaction, and then you can live the rest of your days for yourself, and you're not going to lose that salvation. That's a very true statement, but we don't advise you to do that. And all through 1st and 2 Timothy, in Corinthians, Galatians, Ephesians, all through the writings of the Apostle Paul, he is telling us that we need to do something after salvation, and we call that our sanctification. And Paul says this in 1 Timothy 1:18. "This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went before on thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare." And then, of course, we read this in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 4, as we set the table for today. "Thou therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that thou hast heard of me among many witnesses, the same commit thou to faithful men who shall be able to teach others also. Thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier." Now, I was raised in a military family. My father served in World War II. He was a second lieutenant in the U.S. Army Air Force, and he served during World War II. He served during the Korean conflict, and I was raised with a military haircut, with a military mentality. When our dad would wake us up in the morning, he woke us up like we were sleeping in a barracks, and I get the military mentality. And it is no accident that when we started street preaching back in 2012, that almost every single one of the men that God gave me to preach on the streets, not all of them, but most of them, were military men. The Marine Corps and the Air Force and the Navy and the Coast Guard. And so about 95% of all of our street preachers back in 2012 were military men. And I was talking with one of them yesterday. And you know what he said to me about what it means to be a soldier? Now, he served in the Marines for 6 years. So he knows a little bit about what it means to be a soldier. And he said this to me yesterday. He said, when Paul talks about enduring hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, this is what he means. He said when he was in the Marine Corps, when they would do some sort of a test, like on chemical warfare, and they would set off some sort of chemical warfare explosive in a controlled area, when the test was done, and this sounds like I'm making it up, but I promise you, this is what he told me. When the chemical warfare test was over, the first person that they sent in to check it out was the lowest level grunt that they could find. And they told that guy to put the mask on, put the suit on, and go in and make sure that everything is okay now. And when you give us the all clear, we'll come in. And I'm like, how can that be? The U.S. military, is that what it means to be a soldier in the United States military? Well, he assured me that's exactly what happens in the Marine Corps. So I'm assuming it happens in the Air Force, the Navy, Marines, Navy, Army, and it probably doesn't happen in the Space Force. But you get the idea. When Paul says that we are a soldier in the army of the Lord Jesus Christ, we're not the executive. I know you may think that you're a general, but you're not. We have one commander, and that's the Lord Jesus Christ. And we are the soldiers, and we are the ones who are sent in to do the grunt work. And if you want to know what it means to do grunt work as a soldier of Jesus Christ, just come out with us sometime as we hand out gospel tracts and preach on St. George Street in downtown St. Augustine, and see what it's like when people steal the gospel tracts and pull out switchblades and swing their fists and spit on you from a second floor balcony. And you'll get just a little taste of what it's like to be a soldier in the army of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I said all that to say this. I'm going to talk a little bit today about a man named Jim Elliot. Now, you may not know who Jim Elliot was, but today you are going to find out exactly who he was. You may be familiar with his wife, Elizabeth Elliot, and she was an author. She wrote a lot of books, and God gave her a ministry that lasted for pretty close to half a century. And one of the books that she wrote is called Through the Gates of Splendor. And Lorianne read that book a couple of months ago with tears in her eyes. She said what a great book that was. And it is the story of what happened when her and her husband Jim were called to the mission field. And Jim Elliot died almost immediately after they got there. And then she was called to stay on the field. And she was called to ministry. And that was the plan that God had for him. That was the plan that God had for her. And if you have never read a copy of Through the Gates of Splendor, we highly recommend you go to BibleBeliever.com and get yourself a copy of Through the Gates of Splendor. Also, we are rapidly selling out of the 2024 wall calendar. We still have probably about half of our supply left. But if you're planning on getting a 2024 wall calendar, please do not delay. Go to BibleBeliever.com. And if your order is $75 or more, we're going to give you a free copy of the brand new book by Pastor Joel Tillis called The Little Big Church. And this book will be a blessing to you. And if you are involved in ministry on any level, we highly recommend that you read that book. And if your order, let's just say that you got a calendar, you got a copy of Through the Gates of Splendor, and let's just say that you got, I don't know, Dispensational Truth. If your order is $75 or more, we are going to give you The Little Big Church by Pastor Joel Tillis completely for free. So this is what our Sunday service is about today, laying up in store for yourself a good foundation against the time to come that you may lay hold on eternal life. And at the bottom of the hour, we're going to have our time of prayer and praise. And let me just give you a tantalizing preview of our prayer and praise time. We have been praying for two sisters, Stephanie and her sister Christina. And they both got pregnant at pretty close to the same time. And at 2:35 a.m. this morning, I was not up, but I saw the timestamp when I read it. Stephanie wrote this: "Thank you all for praying tirelessly for my sister Christina. I am thrilled to announce she just had a healthy baby girl Saturday night." That's last night. "Thank you and everybody for praying for her. Please keep praying for me, Stephanie. I am still pregnant with my first child due in June. So please keep me on the prayer list. May the Lord Jesus Christ bless you and your ministry and to all who help. I pray that the Lord will continue to use this ministry for the salvation of more souls around the globe. With love, Stephanie Juliana." She was so excited after her sister gave birth late last night, she sent that email at 2:35 in the morning. Do you think the prayer list is important to people? It is. It is. And if you have a prayer request or a praise report, please post it into the chat room. We'll add it to the list. During the Sunday services, we do the entire list. We do everything. And that's the most important part of the day. So glad that you're here today. If God has been good to you, I was talking with somebody the other day who says that God has never done anything for them. And I said to this person, well, you're saved, aren't you? And they said, yeah. Well, if you can't thank the Lord for anything, can you thank him for sparing your life from the flames of hell, from going to the cross in your place and shedding his blood to pay for your sin? If that's the only thing that you could thank for God for today, wouldn't that be enough? And when you think about it, somebody once said, count your blessings, see what God has done, count your many blessings. And I don't remember the line of that song. But if you do count your blessings, you will see that God has kept you, sustained you. He keeps food on your table. He keeps a roof over your head. He keeps clothes on your back. And you know what Paul says about that? Paul says this: "But godliness with contentment is great gain. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain that we can carry nothing out. And having food and raiment, let us therewith be content." If God has been good to you, say amen.
Of the mercies I have known, I know it may sound simple, but it's more than a cliche. There's no better way to tell you than to say God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. And though I've had my share of hard times, I wouldn't change them if I could, 'cause through it all, God's been good. Times replay, and I can see that I've cried some bitter tears, but I felt His arms around me as I faced my greatest fears. You see, I've had more gains than losses, and I've known more joy than hurt. As His grace rolled down upon me, undeserved, for God's been good in my life. I feel blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. And though I've had my share of hard times, I wouldn't change them if I could, 'cause through it all, God's been good. For God has been my Father, my Savior, and my friend. His love was my beginning, and His love will be my end. I could spend forever trying to tell you everything He is, but the best way that I can say it is this: God's been good in my life. I feel so blessed beyond my wildest dreams when I go to sleep each night. And though I've had my share of hard times, I wouldn't change them if I could, 'cause through it all, God's been good.
The Bible says in Isaiah 63, verse 7, I will mention the loving kindnesses of the Lord and the praises of the Lord, according to all that the Lord hath bestowed on us, and the great goodness toward the house of Israel which He hath bestowed on them, according to His mercies, and according to the multitude of His loving kindnesses. Great is His faithfulness to us.
Yeah.
Amen, amen, Lord, and we thank you for your great faithfulness towards us, Lord, and you never let us go, and from the moment of salvation, we are safe in your hands, and we so very much appreciate that today. And today, we pray for lost souls, Sarah, Eric, Becky Jacobs, Greg and Melissa Price, Glenn Clark, and Jeanette's family, Cheyenne, Bridget, Tony, Dion, Samuel, Matthew, and two great grandbabies, Trista and Tara, Trevor, Derek, Adam, and Roland Carrier and their families, John and David, my two brothers, Jesse and his mom, Rachel's dad, Ralph, Jordan Shapiro, members of the Bolton family, David Peck, Susan Weir's Bicky is praying for her daughters, Valerie and Marie, and her husband, Greg, and for Greg Jr., her son. Jeffrey's children, Tyler Tevin, daughter-in-law, Caitlin, and grandsons, Logan, Ronnie, and Russell. Jeanette and Bob have unsaved family members. Connie, three unsaved kids. Brandy, unsaved family members. Rita in Colorado, praying for Dan. Ron needs to be saved. Spray of Sunshine sons, Daniel, Patrick, and Brian. Shannon praying for Lori W. and Brian M. David Lacker Jan's praying for her son, David. Barbara, please pray for Robert, Naomi, Blake, Alex, Ethan, Raquel, Janet, and Chandel. Nicole Zimmer, praying for her best friend and family, the Meads and the Cooks. Cheyenne, praying for Barry K., Terry C., Alan G., Melody, Nick, Rick, and Beth. Karen's children, Jason and Tiffany. Grandchildren, Summer, Austin, and Emmett. Barbara's son, Jody. Mark Sherlock, praying for Savannah and Mom Stephanie. Werner Bukes, praying for Bob and Abby. Junie, Grant, and their dad need to be saved. Kathy Hughes' son, Zane. Lulu has unsaved family members. Miles has Miles and his family need salvation. Many members of the Giacomino family. Dawn D, praying for David. Paul Caulfield, praying for Father Fred and brother-in-law Frank. Ramona Hayes, praying for daughter Kimberly to be saved and delivered from alcohol. And also salvation prayer for grandchildren, William, Jason, David, and Amanda, and their families. Patrick, praying for Jack and Aaron. Chelsea P., praying for her ex-husband, his parents, his sister, and her husband. Adam's wife, Shayna. Lori B. Shira McPherson, please pray for children Scott, Sherry, and Nicole, as well as an emotional healing. Lori Ann's grandfather, Irvin, Mark Fennell, Kevin Thompson, praying for his father, Tim, sister's husband, John, and other family members, Steve Graves, Elga. Rob is praying for his three kids, Max, Olivia, and Mikey. Phyllis T., praying for her husband. Summer Robbins, praying for her dad, Brian. Todd Broom's brother, Thad. Marie's friends, family, Ashley, Dayton, Alyssa, Kyle, Brandon, Grace, Micah, and Macy. Adam and Katie, praying for parents, sisters, brother-in-law, nieces, and nephews. Joe Rusiello, please pray for my mom, sister, granddaughter to get saved. Ellen is praying for her grandsons, Braden and Logan. His Grace is praying for Rob, Summer, Sue and Mike, Carl, Jason and Rachel, and Jason and Carrie. Lola's son William and wife Lindsay, Hannah's mom, Anja, praying for Hanu, John, Charles, and Anna Lilsa, Dave Evans, praying for Taylor, Viviana, praying for her brother Javier Reyes, Adam and Katie, praying for their neighbors Jason, Eddie, and Brian, Loretta Oates, praying for her sons Kenny and Matthew, Jane is praying for son Troy, Julie Lynn, for Katie Ann, Chona, salvation prayer for Estefano Jr., Eugenia and her kids, Marisol and Cherry, and her siblings, Julia and Maria Tricia. Chuck Edgerton would like prayer for his son Jacob and mom Lynette. Samantha praying for Beth, Deborah Hare for unsaved family members, Rita, unsaved Catholic family members, Teresa, unsaved family members, Lisa is praying for her father John, Annabal, unsaved children, Deborah Milton's son Billy, Hap Nightingale for his sons Jimmy and Zach, Don Huff, Claire, and Virginia, Norman Merkel praying for daughter Kara, granddaughter Ava, son-in-law Stephen Matthews, and Lynette Crew, Henrique Larson praying for his parents Kygel and Elizabeth, his sister and her spouse Ingrid and Frederick, and his mom's aunt Barrett. Roz is praying for lost family members. Brian needs to get saved. Andrew Whittington. Marisol Barcina praying for Catholic family members. Rapture 57, unsaved family. Gail is praying for Jim. Shirley Medor for her brother and his wife. Eric Brian Yui in the Philippines for his parents Anna and Norillo, members of his family, and co-workers. Tony the Carpenter and his son Cole. Kenny B., unsaved family, Rachel K., unsaved family, Sandra C., unsaved family, Marky Mark, unsaved family, Regina Danner, salvation prayer for Kelly, Chris, Cisco, Richard, Wayne, John, Sandra, Tamara, Hazel, and Jimmy, Haley's aunt and family, Carol from Georgia would like to see her sister, and Aunt Joey, who is 101, get saved. The Breida family, Stacy praying for her husband, Rachel Adams praying for Kim, Jesse, Angelina, Carrie, Mikey, Alyssa, and Stan, Ashley for salvation and to overcome addiction, Mark for his sons Matthew, Michael, Mason, and daughter Michaela for salvation, Mitch praying for his daughters Rachel and Hannah, postal workers and delivery people who service the bookstore, Jericho praying for his family, Brenda's husband Paul, Kenny, salvation prayers for friends and family, Amanda Stern would like salvation prayer for Melanie and Payden, the Muto family, Steph, Terry, would like salvation prayer for her family, and Steph is praying for Michael. Xavier, he's praying for his mom Reyes, wife Salma, daughters, and extended family members. Maria Silva would like to see her Jehovah's Witness family in Venezuela get saved. Donna Lynn praying for children Shannon, Todd, Kaylin, and Jake. Tiffany Brown is asking salvation prayer for her mother-in-law. The LaPiana family asking salvation prayer for extended family members. Dave Evans for his friend Diana. Sue Duchesne for son Norman. CJ's mom. Shira Shine praying for Kevin, Michelle, and Lewis. Loretta Watsney's husband and children need to be saved. Rebecca Lynn praying for Joel Smith. Shirley praying for Marie, Haley, Patricia, Jaden, Richard, Patricia S., Joshua, Ruby, Gerald, Josiah, Monice, and her husband Hamid and his family. Marianne Ellie's kids, Anne Marie and Christine, as well as grandkids, Sophia, Jacob, David, and Katrina. Tracy and Ralph Wallace, please pray for son-in-law Ethan, daughter Shanna, and grandson Caden, all for salvation issues. Beth Peck's husband David, as well as children Heather and Damien. Terry Ewing's daughter Bryn, Teresa M's sons James, Frank, and Peter. Jose De La Rosa's mom Alicia. Patricia T praying for her son Adam and other family members. Chelsea and Brian Plagman for son Bryce and girlfriend Eva. Zuzana for salvation. Vladimira would like prayer for her husband Ken and her friend Katka for salvation. Steph is praying for her brother Michael. Cassandra for her husband Todd and sons Nathan and Andrew, and her son Sonny is backslidden. Marie Sim, please pray for my ex-husband who is a Mason, as well as my son John and his family, daughter Tracy, and her family. Jean-Paul Mesa, please pray for my Catholic mom to get saved. Deborah Mack, praying for John and Brenda. Zach Jeffson's mom, Katrina. Chelsea P, praying for Mike T. Mia in Texas, please pray for my children, Kimberly, Danielle, and AJ. Holly, please add my husband Nick to the list. Rob, for my friend Eddie. Deborah Mack, I've witnessed to a woman named Brandy. Please, and her whole family needs to get saved. Brandy, Evan, Anna, and Aiden. Char would like salvation prayer for her mom and extended family members. That's 148 entries with about 200 plus people. If you have a lost loved one that you very much desire to see get saved, please let us know and we'll put that name onto the list, and we'll be very happy to keep them there for as long as need be. God operates outside of time. We may be in a hurry, but God seldom is. People who need a healing today at the top of our list: Lorianne's mother Joyce, my mother-in-law, diagnosed with a tumor in her breast the size of a tangerine, very large lump, and she is starting chemotherapy very soon. Please pray for a good CT scan on Tuesday. That may have been last week, but suffice to say, please pray for Lorianne's mom, Joyce, for a healing. My brother Jimmy, that many of you have been praying for over the past 6 or 7 weeks, he had a little bit of a backwards slide this week. And some of the earlier things that were bothering him have come back. Little bit of brain fog. He has fluid in his abdominal cavity. And he's not doing as well as he was doing. So please keep my brother Jimmy in your prayers. Amanda Emaw, possible return of cancer. Thomas, experiencing profound discouragement. Annetta, she had a stroke in 2022, and we are praying for her to have a complete physical healing. Everything is fine except the left side of her body, and it doesn't work right. So please keep Annetta in your prayers. Dave, asking prayer for Mom Laura, who had a stroke. Sadie has heart-related issues. Derek O'Reilly for anxiety. Marcia Swanson has a neuroimmune disease. George H. has health issues. James Rivette for recovering from addiction and mental health issues. Robert Wiley is battling ALS. Jill Puckett is losing her vision. Paul Caulfield has type 1 sugar diabetes. Ron Alliston has cancer. Brooke Kettlecamp has autism, but she continues to improve. Please keep Brooke Kettlecamp on your list. My friend Krista, battling a massive tumor in her chest, and I am starting to fear the worst. I have not heard back from her in about 2.5 months, and I am hopeful to hear something soon, but please, let's just assume that she's still battling that tumor. Please pray for Krista and her husband and their 4 children. Dan Kane, please pray for my wife Roxy with MS and son Jonathan. Rob's friend Mike has MS. Ida Karulik has cancer. Mark Seals has health issues. Roz has asthma and scoliosis. Tony is blind, has cancer, and his wife is divorcing him. Maddie Luck has Lewy body dementia, and her daughter Michelle has severe neuropathy and fibromyalgia. Tracy has arthritis in her spine, fatty liver, and diabetes type 2. Michelle Christian has bone cancer. Melissa B's husband Brian has stage 3 kidney disease. Ricky Guda needs prayer for her eyesight. Daughter Norcia is having thyroid surgery. And please pray for her for that. A woman named KC is battling lupus and kidney issues. Jane would like salvation prayer for her parents and brother and a physical healing for her husband. Brooke's sister Ashley has MS. Jackie H. needs God's favor regarding custody of her son. A woman named Katka suffers from ALS. Dave Evans' friend Manuela has bone cancer. Stacy is going through a divorce and needs wisdom. Terry Horn has had several strokes and now needs a walker. Casey, please keep my husband on your prayer list. He is unsaved and a severe alcoholic. Matthew Morrow, battling back after a alcohol relapse. And please keep his parents, Dan and Peggy, in your prayers for strength and wisdom from the Lord. Julius says, please continue to pray for my mom, Erlinda, and niece, Rochelle, for health issues. Brooke's friend's child, Birdie, 2 years old, had a stroke and then started having seizures. Please pray for little Birdie, 2 years old. Jeanette's sister continues to improve after having eye surgery. But we're keeping her on the list. Wayne needs prayer for cancer. Not sure if he's saved. Ashley DeShields, battling West Nile virus. And if you're listening, Ashley, please give us an update. Thank you. Teresa G, asking prayer for her eyesight. She suffers from macular degeneration. Shira Shine, please keep me and my family in your prayers. And a rift has happened because of her stand for the Lord. And so please pray that God would do something there. She said that the pain of not being allowed time with her grandchild hurts worse than cancer. And she had cancer last year, and we prayed her through that. So please keep Shira Shine in your prayers. Ladies who are expecting, our daughter Megan Burton is now 5 days overdue. And that is not, the doctors are not concerned, but please pray for our daughter Megan that she would deliver soon and the baby and mom would be healthy and that everything would be good in the Burton family. Thank you. Christy Ireland is pregnant. Char's daughter Miranda. Sandra Carbonera's friend Jordan P. Stephanie Juliana and my sister Christina. Well, we are taking her off the list. I gave that praise report earlier, and what a blessing that that is. And we are so glad that we have this list and we can pray for pregnant moms. And if you're expecting, if you know somebody that's expecting, please reach out and let us know. And keep Stephanie Juliana in your prayer. She is due in June. Sarah Ann Severson, daughter of Bob and Cindy Kettlecamp, expecting first child in May. Spray of Sunshine, please pray for my son and his girlfriend who are expecting twins. Amen. Mark Saxa would like prayer for his son Joseph to return to the Lord. Jan Lacker has many things that she's praying for, not the least of which is for a physical healing in her body and salvation for her son David and for her marriage to be repaired. Lots of prayer requests in the Lacker family. Char still waiting for their prison ministry to be restarted. Linda praying for son Stephen to return to the Lord. Julie Baird need prayer about living situation and finances. Deborah Mack, please pray for Devin Miller. Lost Lake Lass, my son Tristan went missing on November 29th. And if you're listening, please reach out and let us know the status. Linda LaPiana, please pray for our children, Stephen, Danielle, and Christopher to return to the Lord, and also Stephen and his wife, Hannah's financial situation. Also, please pray for Joe LaPiana. We found out the other day that he lost his job, and we are lifting him up in prayer. The Bible says that God owns the cattle on a thousand hills, and we are believing in faith that God will bring a new and better situation for Joe and Linda. But please keep them in your prayers. People with an unspoken today, the LaPiana family, Jeanette, Adrian P. Breda, Debbie Mathias, Rachel Adams, Julius, Dave Evans, Ricky Gouda, Blaine, Jennifer, Carol from Georgia, Ron M., Erad Byramumishu, Bonnie, Marie Comfort, Julie Baird, Amanda Stern, Rob, Steph, Marie C., Julius, Mona and Leah, Angela, Brooke, Linda, Lulu, and Linda Pippin. Please keep our free Bible and Gospel Tract program in your prayers. I'll have an update later in the program today. And also, please pray for our overseas pastors. In the Philippines, Pastors John Reed, Danny, and Arnell. Vietnam, Pastor Fo John. In Turkey, Luann is an American missionary to the Muslims. In India, Pastor David Mark. In the UK, Stephen McCarroll. In Uganda, our own Erad Byramumishu. And in Spain, we have jail preacher Xavier. Please keep our street preachers in your prayer. In the U.S., we have Brian Kelly of the King James Bible Baptist Church, Kyle and Reagan Gorzel, Marie in Philadelphia, Mike Abram, Jay in New York City, Joe Rusiello in Eagle Pass, Texas, which is currently at civil war with the government, Joshua Gaskins. But what a great time to hand out gospel tracts. Joshua Gaskins has a gospel tract ministry in Virginia. And Aaron and Teresa McMahon of CPR Missions. Up in Canada, Paul and Peggy Caulfield, Adrian Breda, Werner Bukes. South Africa, we have Arthur Hueys. And in Australia, we have Henry Biggs and Jennifer Thompson. All right, let's go to the chat room today where Heath is asking, would you please ask the Lord to help me through issues I am battling? Absolutely. I already gave you Stephanie's amazing early morning praise report about her sister Christina delivering a healthy baby, and everybody's fine. Amen to that. Charlie on the highway, that's our own Charlton. Prayer request, healing and guidance for my wife Deb, for our friend Heidi, and guidance for daughter Haley as she has decisions to make as a young lady. Kyle Gorzel, update on Reagan's grandfather. Praise the Lord, he has been cleared from the hospital and back home now. And we'll be waiting on test results to determine where all the antibodies are coming from within him. So we have prayed for her granddad over the course of a couple years now. And bit by bit, he is doing better. And Kyle and Reagan say thank you. Karen says, please put my granddaughter Summer at the top of the prayer list. She got cancer when she was 15. She is 20 now, and she had to have emergency surgery on her spine. She is also having a doctor's appointment this week because her spine has other issues going on. So please pray for God to show mercy and not let it be too serious. But most of all, please pray for her salvation and her father's, which is my son, Jason. So Karen says, please pray for granddaughter Summer and her father, Jason. Amen. Rapture 57, please pray for my son, his wife, and their marriage. Chelsea P., salvation prayer for my ex-husband. We share children. My son is 10, and he told me last night that he asked his dad if he believes in Jesus, and he claims that his dad said yes, so I'm hoping this is true. And we have been praying for her ex-husband for probably 2 years already, and that is good progress. Amen. Juanita has an unspoken. Linda, please add Richard Kitzmiller to the list for salvation. And I didn't see him on the list, but I am certain he will get there. Please pray for Richard for salvation. Heath, please pray for my grandmother. She has breathing problems. I think it's because she took the shot. She is saved. So please lift up Heath's grandmother in your prayers. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God. We praise you. And Lord, we say this every single time, but it's true. If you don't do it, it's not going to get done. If you don't give it to us, we're not going to have it. And we are content to be 100% dependent on you. And whatever the prayer need is, cancer, stroke, blood clots, brain seizures, heart attack, MS, living situations, job situations, finances, people who need to be restored, people who need reconciliation, people who need to get saved, Lord, this is where you do your work. And what an honor and a privilege that it is that we can come before you and we can pray. And we can ask you to get involved and to insert yourself and get something done, Father God. However you want to work it out, however you want to bring it to pass is fine with us. And Jim Elliot, he had that same mindset. And I don't think he knew how short his life was going to be. And I'm positive that he didn't know when him and his wife Elizabeth signed on to be missionaries to take your gospel to uncharted areas. They thought that it could happen, but I think that everybody was surprised how quickly it happened. And yet, Lord, This is the, I mean, this, that's the New Testament. That's the life of the Apostle Paul. And we are to constantly press toward the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. And let that be our concern today. Let that be our focus today. God, you know we need food on the table. You know we need a roof over our head, clothes on our back. You know we need jobs. You know we need healing. You know we need all of these things. And Father God, as your body, as a church family, we just say, Lord, wash us clean of our many sins. Forgive us for where we fail you, Lord, but you are ever faithful. Draw us closer to yourself. And Lord, do for us that which we cannot do for ourselves. And we'll thank you and we'll praise you and give you all the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I love our prayer list, and I have been on it a time or two. My loved ones are on it now. Your loved ones are on it now. And believe me when I tell you that it is a honor and a privilege to be able to pray for each other and to esteem the needs of each other more than our own. That's what Paul says. That's what the gospel is. And I'm just so glad that we are a praying people, that Now the End Begins is a praying family of people across America, around the world. And when we come together, there is power. There is power when we pray. So thank you so much for supporting this prayer and praise time. There's not a whole lot of other broadcasts that do this, but we do it, and we're happy to do it. All right, one or two more songs, and we're going to get right into our message today. Laying hold on eternal life and building a good foundation against the time that is coming for you and me. And we'll be right back after this.
Lost my home, angels cry.
Amen, amen. Kimmy D has an amazing praise report. She says, praise report, my neighbor Pam. Oh, hold on. Oh, boy. Kimmy D has an amazing praise report. She says, my neighbor Pam received her free Bible yesterday. She said it is the most beautiful book she has ever seen. She accepted Jesus as her Savior and is so very thankful. This is why we have the free Bible and Gospel Track program. Did you know that every single day that the bookstore is open, we get requests for free Bibles, New Testament, scripture portions, gospel tracts from all over America and all around the world. And we rejoice with Kimmy and her neighbor Pam. And Kimmy stepped into the gap and got a free Bible for her neighbor. She loves it. She's grateful. She received the gospel and now she is saved and so very, very thankful. When you support, and let me just give a little plug for the free Bible program. When you support the NTEB free Bible and Gospel Track program, as well as Bibles Behind Bars, this is where your support goes. Just 2 days ago, we got an email from Chaplain David at the Coffee Creek Correctional Facility, the only women's prison in the entire state of Oregon. And he says there is a great need for King James large print Bibles. Your donation will be used wisely for the glory of God. And this is why we have a free Bible program, the most important program that we have. And if you would like to help support this program, just go to nowtheendbegins.com or go to biblesbehindbars.com and send us a donation so that we can continue to do this great work. And it is amazing. Pam got saved. She got a free Bible. And this is why we do what we do. So we rejoice with you, Kimmy. We are so glad that God has given you fruit for your labors. And I hope that it's going to encourage each and every one of us to witness more and hand out gospel tracts more and do what Kimmy did. If you know somebody that needs a free Bible, and you're really certain that they, on some level, that they will use it, that they will read it, just go to nowtheendbegins.com, click on the link for the free Bible, put their address in, and send them a free Bible. This is why the program is there. And I am so excited that Pam got saved, and what a blessing that is. So good job, Kimmy. And this is what happens when people get on fire for the Lord and people get saved and people get right. And you know what? If somebody has that Laodicean spirit, well, that can spread and infect people. But if somebody's on fire for God, that can spread and that can touch people as well. So amen, Kimmy. So glad that Pam is saved, and please encourage her to tune in for these Bible studies. And again, this free Bible program that we have, it's expensive. We pay for the shipping. We pay for the purchasing of the Bibles. We send them out, and we need your help to do it. So please go to BiblesBehindBars.com and make a donation today. Thank you so very much. All right, open up your Bibles today. 1 Timothy chapter 6. 1 Timothy chapter 6. And let's look down in verse 17 through 19. My text for today is actually verse 19, but let's get it in context. 1 Timothy 6:17, Paul says, charge them that are rich in this world that they be not high-minded, nor trust in uncertain riches, but in the living God, who giveth us richly all things to enjoy. That they do good, that they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Heavenly Father, be with me as I preach and teach. Let it be a blessing for the hearers. And we pray if there is one lost who is listening, that something will be said and done to lead that lost soul to you. And for those who are listening and are saved, we pray that something will be said and done today to set a lukewarm soul on fire for you. And for the rest of us, God, please continue to sustain us and give us everything we need to do the job you've called us to do here on the front lines of the end times. And in Jesus' name we pray, amen. So Paul is talking to Timothy, and he says, hey, nothing wrong with rich people, but make sure that you tell them that they don't put their trust in their wealth and that they do something with that wealth that's going to bring glory to God. That they be rich in good works, ready to distribute, willing to communicate. You know, we wouldn't have a free Bible program. We wouldn't have Bibles behind bars if it wasn't for thousands and thousands of people who were willing to pray for this program and donate to this program. And a number of people who are fairly well off have made large donations, which have allowed us to send out over 250,000 Bibles, New Testaments, gospel tracts, and scripture portions. So the Bible has nothing against rich people. And in fact, rich people can be a great blessing to the cause of Christ. But Paul says, be very careful that you tell them, Timothy, not to trust in their wealth, that they need to be rich in good works. And he says this in verse 19, laying up in store for themselves a good foundation against the time to come. And you know what? That's the time that nobody likes to talk about. That's the time that nobody likes to think about. We think about being taken up in the rapture. And that's great. We focus on that because Paul says that we are to comfort one another with these words in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 that he gives us about the rapture. And it is certainly comforting to be looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, and waiting for that eastern sky to break open, waiting to hear, come up hither. That's great stuff. But what if the Lord tarries? Dr. Ruckman lived to be, how old was he when he died? About 96 years old when he died. He ministered on the front lines of the end times for 64 years. He was fairly certain that he would live long enough to see the rapture. He did not. And he lived to almost 100, and he had a 64-year ministry. I can't imagine that. This is the 15th year of Now the End Begins, and believe me, I love it. I love all of it, and I am so happy and amazed and astounded with how God continues to expand it and increase it. But that's only 15 years. I would need another 45, 46, 40. Wow, I can't imagine having a ministry for 64 years and then not living long enough to see the rapture. So Paul says this, you need to lay up in store for yourself a good foundation against the time to come, that is your death, that they may lay hold on eternal life. Now, when Paul is telling Timothy that you got to preach to them how to lay hold on eternal life, it's It may be a little different than what you think it might be. Turn to the book of Philippians. Turn to the book of Philippians and let's just set the table for talking about Jim Elliot and how he laid down his life for the cause of Christ. Philippians chapter 3, let's start in verse 7. Philippians 3, 7. Paul says, but what things were gained to me, he was in good standing with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He had letters from the chief priests to do what he did. He learned at the feet of Gamaliel. Saul had a pretty good life. The only thing was he wasn't saved. And he says, but what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. If you're going to follow the Lord, you're going to have to give some things up. And look, we all battle with the flesh. We all battle with sin, and we should battle with sin. If you're struggling with addiction, if you're struggling with anything that the Bible calls sin, you should battle that, and you should be diligent about that, and you should be going before the Lord and asking Him to give you the victory in those things. You absolutely should be. But some of the things where Paul says, those I counted loss for Christ, this life that we live. Now, in just a couple of weeks, I'm going to be celebrating 33 years of being saved. And you know what's really hard to do? It is really, really hard to serve the Lord more than you serve this world. That's a really, really hard thing to do. And I have tried and failed and tried and failed and tried and tried and tried again. And it seems to me, and I don't know, maybe you don't feel this way. Maybe it's just me. And if it is, that's fine. But in 33 years of being saved, it has been a constant battle to serve the Lord and not allow the devil to steal it from me and then have to go back to the beginning and start all over again. Now, what are some of the things that can prevent you from serving the Lord? Focusing on sports more than you focus on the Bible. Now, I'm not preaching against watching football or baseball or basketball. I'm not even saying that watching those things or attending those things are sinful. I'm not saying that. But you can't do two things at one time. God can. You're not God. You can't. So you have to pick one thing at a time that you want to do. Now, Jim Elliot had something in common with the Apostle Paul in that he chose to focus on the things of Christ. Paul says, what things were gained to me, things that I enjoyed doing for myself, those were things that prevented me from serving the Lord. And he says, yea, doubtless, and I count all things, verse 8, but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ. Now, you might say, well, wait a second, Paul. What are you talking about? Giving up everything so that you might win Christ? You're a saved man. What are you talking about, Paul? He is not talking about salvation. He is talking about sanctification. And Paul had to make a choice. If you read in Acts chapter 9, and I'm pretty sure that Saul asks Jesus this very important question, Acts 9:5. Yeah, here it is. And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. And he, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me to do? He could have said no. He could have put up a fuss. He could have said anything other than what he said. But when he came face to face with the risen Lord, He knew that playtime was over, and he simply said, "Lord, what wilt thou have me to do?" And then Paul says this in Philippians 3:9, "And be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith." This is his salvation. But then the next verse is his sanctification. Philippians 3:10, "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings." Well, who wants to do that? Well, if you want to be a Christian, that's what you got to do. "That I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead." Now, Paul is the same guy who says three times in three places, "Be ye followers of me." And so when Paul says these things, he is not just talking. He is not just saying these beautiful poetic things so that he can write some scripture. He is telling me and he is telling you that if we want to lay hold on eternal life, that we need a good foundation and that we have to do these things, being conformable unto his death and the fellowship of his sufferings, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Now, let's talk about Jim Elliot for just a moment. I want to read this little blurb that I found online. And it says this: "On Tuesday, January 3rd of 1956, Jim Elliot and four other missionaries landed on a small strip of land in the jungles of Ecuador. It was a dangerous landing, and they could not all land at once. For years, they had been dreaming of and planning for this moment. Their hearts were set on reaching the Auca Indians with the good news of Jesus." So the first thing that I want to point out is that Jim Elliot, his wife Elizabeth, and therefore missionary friends and their wives, they were completely sold out to the cause of Christ. And they were dreaming and planning this moment to go to the Auca Island to meet with the Auca Indians, but there's a problem. The Aucas were a notoriously dangerous tribe. They were unreached by missionaries. Nobody had ever reached them. Some people had exchanged gifts, but always the Aucas had attacked them. For 3 months, the missionaries had been regularly flying over the area, dropping gifts and shouting greetings. When they landed, they built a hut and waited for the Aucas to come and find them. They knew the dangers. Their wives had discussed the possibility of becoming widows. Elizabeth Elliot, the wife of Jim Elliot, says that they went simply because they knew they belonged to God, because he was their creator and their redeemer. They had no choice but to willingly obey him, and that meant obeying his command to take the good news to every nation. Now, I understand that all of us are not called to be missionaries, and certainly not called to be foreign missionaries. All of us are not called to be Sunday school teachers or preachers or pastors. I get all that. And Paul has a lot to say about, he gave some apostles and prophets and preachers and teachers and all those different things. And we are all called to do what God has in store for us if you're saved. But it is the mental attitude and the heart attitude in which you approach those things that is very, very important. Now, Jim Elliot, and I'll be really honest with you, Jim Elliot, when you read about him and you read the things that he wrote in his diary, you're very tempted to say, this guy can't be for real. Nobody would think like this in mid-20th century America. He wrote things like this. Oh, the fullness, pleasure, sheer excitement of knowing God on earth. I care not if I ever raise my voice again for him, if only I may love him and please him. Wow. And that's a young man in his 20s, and his diary is filled with writing just like that. So, Jim Elliot was as sold out as you could ever possibly be. And so him and his wife and their four friends and their wives, you know what they planned to do? They planned to dare something great for God. And they prayed about it, and God gave them the green light, and they took, I don't have time to tell you about the preparations that they took, and those stories are amazing. You got to get that book, Through the Gates of Splendor. You can go to BibleBeliever.com. We sell it. It's a fantastic book. Highly advise that you get this book. But Jim and Elizabeth and their friends, all they wanted to do was serve God. Now, have you ever wondered why we live in a world that is so filled with entertainment? And I'm not talking about, you know, the striptease and pornography and all that junk. Not talking about that stuff. What I'm talking about, have you ever wondered why we live in a world that is so absolutely filled to overflowing with entertainment? Because the devil is working overtime to distract you, to tie you up, to get you thinking in a different direction. During football season, and I think it's some sort of a playoff game this afternoon. I'm not really sure who's playing. But if you drive past the Jaguars Stadium in Jacksonville on any Sunday when they're playing, you will see 47,000 people sitting in 47,000 seats with a couple of hundred more people in the rampways and outside. And there's like an outside area where, I don't know, it's like this whole big complex. Now, is it wrong or sinful to go and watch the Jaguars play football on a Sunday? No. And I'm not trying to make you feel guilty for doing it, but I'm just asking you a question. Do you get that excited? Think it, and look, I was a Pittsburgh Steelers fan for many, many years, and I still am. I still have them with fond affection, but I don't spend time. I mean, I've watched maybe two football games in the last 4 years, and the reason for that is because God convicted me that I could get more excited about watching the Steelers score touchdowns than I could about a sermon being preached in church. And look, all these things are vying for your attention, and more than that, they're vying for your affection. And we live in a world that has all the football shirts and jerseys and posters and bumper stickers and, you know, Broncos fan on board and all those different things. And it gets you to commit to this system of entertainment. And by doing that, you are now, at the very least, you have one foot in and you have one foot out. Jim Elliot was a man that bypassed all of that stuff from the very beginning. He gets married to Elizabeth, and they want to go to this island in Ecuador, and they want to see these Auca Indians get saved. January 6th was a Friday. Three Aucas, two women and one man, approached them. They exchanged greetings. The missionary showed them rubber bands, yo-yos, and balloons, and the man was taken up in the plane for a plane ride. By Sunday, January 8th, they were due to radio in at 4:30, but there was silence. When no message came, a plane was sent and then a rescue party. Four of the bodies were recovered, all of them had been lanced to death. All of them had been lanced to death. The fifth body was never found. It seems that they were ambushed. All five were martyred, and this is in the 1950s. All five were martyred for the sake of Christ. All were married, and four of them had children. One wife was pregnant. Her three-year-old was heard to tell the new crying baby, "Never you mind, when we get to heaven, I'll show you which one is daddy." Now, Jim Elliot said this, and I want you to think about what he said. And this is the essence of my message today. And I'm going to give you scripture to back this up. Jim Elliot once said, "He is no fool who gives up what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose." Jim Elliot had seen through the lie of entertainment and consumerism. He had seen the emptiness that this world offers. He had realized the far greater value of the new creation that God promises. Now let me give you some scripture. 1 Timothy 1:18. "This charge I commit unto thee, son Timothy, according to the prophecies which went on before thee, that thou by them mightest war a good warfare." 1 Timothy 2:1. "I exhort therefore that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men." Prayer is at the bedrock of our walk with the Lord. Not just prayer for ourselves, but for those around us, for our loved ones, for our leaders. 1 Timothy 4:6. "If thou put the brethren in remembrance of these things, thou shalt be a good minister of Jesus Christ, nourished up in the words of faith and of good doctrine whereunto thou hast attained." And so Paul tells Timothy, look, Timothy, all this stuff that I'm writing, Romans, Galatians, Philippians, Colossians, all this stuff that I'm writing, 1 and 2 Corinthians, 1 and 2 Thessalonians, all the 1 and 2 Timothy, all these things, Timothy, that I'm writing, you put them in remembrance and you minister these words of faith. You give them this good doctrine, and that is how they are going to lay a good foundation for the time to come. 1 Timothy 4:15. "Meditate upon these things. Give thyself wholly to them, that thy profiting may appear to all." You know, one thing that you will find in every legitimate work of the Holy Spirit when it comes to revival is that people will be excited, not excited about going to a church service that's nothing more than a rock concert, not that type of excitement, but people will be excited by the preaching and teaching and hearing of the gospel. If doctrine doesn't excite you, that is a massive red flag. Now, you might think that doctrine is boring and that it's dry and that it's dusty. It is not. Bible doctrine, especially the doctrine that Paul writes, is, well, for a Christian, it's the most exciting thing in the Bible. It shows you how to have a walk with the Lord and how you can be useful to Him and how you can get something done that will make it through the judgment seat of Christ and how you can lay up in store for yourself that good foundation against the time to come and that you can lay hold on eternal life. So let me just wrap all, give me 5 minutes and let me just wrap all this up for you. My brother, as you know, has been sick. And when Lori and I went up there on that emergency trip, and, you know, honestly, the dates aren't even in my head. It was like 2 weeks ago. I don't even remember the actual dates that we went up, but it was just a couple of weeks ago. And he's 66, I'm 62. And walking into that bed where he was, that room, that hospital room where he was lying there in the bed, and seeing his weak and frail body, somebody that I have always known in my life to be my much stronger older brother, always worked outside, always worked with his hands. The only person back when I was in my 20s and working out, the only person I could never beat at arm wrestling because he was just too strong. And he really, I mean, you would shake his hand and he worked outside and just a strong grip with rough skin and just a really physically strong person. And then to walk into that room and see him not even having enough strength to lift his foot onto the bed, not having enough physical coordination to extract his hand from being wrapped up in the sheets, and that faraway look in his eye, and you could just see how close to death he really was. And on one hand, it broke my heart for my brother and for his situation and for his condition. Anybody looking at a family member or a loved one in that condition, you are filled with an overwhelming feeling of sympathy, empathy, compassion, and that anything that you could do for that person, you absolutely would do. And we did. We drove up there in a snowstorm to go see him. But then on the other side, seeing my brother like that in that bed, man, oh man, was that a reminder to me that this clock is ticking and this old world has a date with destiny, and we don't know how much time that we have left, how much God has allotted to each and every one of us. Since 2020, we have prayed for and seen God take home many of our members in Now the End Begins. And people that we have prayed for, some people like Mark Bennett, who was one of our street preachers, Bob Lieb, who was a NTEB-er all the way back from 2009, and he's home with the Lord, and you just don't know how much time that you have left. You just don't. You just don't. And when I saw my brother in that hospital bed, half of me was my heart was broken in compassion for his physical condition and earnest prayers for his recovery. But that other half of me was looking at him, and it's like the Lord was saying, take a good look. Take a good look. Because that could be you one day. And that's the attitude. When you really read the writings of the Apostle Paul, that is what he is trying to impart to us. He is trying to impart that sense of urgency, that sense of all is not the way it seems, all is not well, and that there is a spiritual battle that's being drawn out and taking place, and you and I are in the midst of that spiritual battle. And as we try to get something done for the Lord, Satan raises up people like little chess pieces to pop up in front of us and attempt to restrict our forward movement. And you've got to make sure that you know what you know and that you believe what you believe. Paul says this, for I am persuaded, he said, Romans chapter 8, verse 38, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Paul knew what he believed, and he knew and believed that God was able to keep that which he had committed to him against that day. What day is that day? Well, that day is this day. 2 Timothy 4:6, and I'll be done. Paul says, "For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand." Paul says to Timothy, "Three things that you need to know on my way out. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith." Sounds like simple things to do until you try to do them, and you have Satan and his minions raising up people, places, and situations to try to take that out of your hand and to stop you from fighting that good fight, to try to prevent you from finishing your course, and trying to block you from keeping the faith. And Paul says, because he did those things, "Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, the judgment seat of Christ, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." Can I challenge you today to take a good, close, honest look at your walk with the Lord and just make a little mental list of where you spend your time and the things that you give your attention and your affections to? Maybe you love sports, and maybe you love music and all those other things, and that's great. I'm not preaching against those things. But where is your attention? Where is your affections? And at the very least, do you do the things of the Lord as much as you do those things? Are you as excited to go to church and hear the gospel being preached and doctrine being taught? Are you as excited about the things that are contained in your King James Bible as you are about the NFL playoffs happening today? Because if not, then there's a problem, and there is a rift and a disconnect. But the good news is that once you become aware of it, you can fix it. And I don't watch football games anymore. Not because I got convicted that they were bad or they were sinful or anything else, but because I wanted to be as excited about seeing souls get saved and the Bible being preached as I did about watching the Steelers score touchdowns. And when you look in your life and you look at the things that you really like to do, how many of those things are Bible-based? Now, Paul said, and I'll end where I started, 1 Timothy 6:19, laying up in store for themselves. This is for your benefit. Paul is trying to help us. He says that when you do these things, you're going to lay up in store for yourself a good foundation against the time to come, that they may lay hold on eternal life. And I have said this before, and I'll say it again. 60 seconds after you're in heaven, if you haven't lived your life like this, or at least tried to do it, if you haven't had that 1 Timothy 6:19 mindset, you're going to be up in heaven awaiting the judgment seat of Christ and knowing that you were not prepared. And the sad part is like the sad part of people who wind up in hell. You don't have to go. Nobody has to go to hell. I know that John MacArthur and all the rest of those people, they like to teach that God created people purely for the purpose of damning them in hell, that he may be glorified. John Calvin may have believed that, but you won't find that in the Bible anywhere. Paul is trying to help you. He is showing you how to lay up in store for yourself, how to build a good foundation for yourself. At the judgment seat of Christ, you'll be so very glad that you were prepared. And the good news is, Christ hasn't come yet. We pray that he comes tonight. But whenever he decides to come and get us, either through the rapture or through our own death, whenever that day is, you're going to be very, very glad that you at least tried to put off the things of the world and all those things that so easily distract us and pull us away. Paul says the sin that does so easily beset us. What is that verse? Hebrews chapter 11. Nope, 12. Yep. Paul says this: wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, give us this mindset that your word talks about. And all these scriptures from 1 Timothy and these verses from Hebrews 12. Lord, we just pray that you would allow us to have a little bit of that same mindset that Jim Elliot had, that his wife Elizabeth had, that D.L. Moody had, that all the people that got something done for you, Lord, they all seem to have this one thing in common, and they were focused on you. They had their eyes on the prize. Let us be counted in that number, Lord, and give us strength, give us wisdom, give us the power that we need to do these things, Lord, and draw us closer to yourself. And we'll thank you and praise you and give you all the glory for it, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, we've come to the end of our time for today. I hope that this message was a blessing to you. Jim Elliot was a very different type of individual. He is a very unique man, and God used him in a very unique way. And wouldn't that be a wonderful thing if each and every one of us could say, Lord, use me like that. Maybe not to be slaughtered by the Auca Indians, but in whatever way that God decided that using you would bring him glory. Isn't that an amazing thing? I know I said that I was finishing, but John chapter 21, and then I promise I'll be done. John chapter 21. Where is that verse? Here it is. Jesus says to Peter in verse 18, verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou was young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying by what death he, Peter, should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he said unto him, follow me. How about you, Christian? Can you follow him? I think you can. All you have to do is want to do it. And with that, we've come to the end of our time. Lord willing, we'll see you back here tonight, 7 p.m. Eastern Time, for another NTEB Rightly Dividing Bible Study. Have a great afternoon, everybody.
There'll be no sorrows there, and no more burdens to bear. Bye.